So this video will go over section 4.7 on electronegativity and bond polarity. Electronegativity is a measure of an atom's attraction for electron in a bond. It tells how much a particular atom wants the electrons. So atoms, even though they share electrons, they may not share equally necessarily. And so the more electronegative electron will pull the electrons towards itself more strongly than a less electronegative element. And so the electronegativity varies this way according to the periodic table. Going from left to right, the electronegativity increases, and going from bottom to top, it increases. And so the values range from 0.8 for rubidium on the lower left corner, and they will go up to 4.0 for fluorine in the upper right corner. So for this particular section, you will need to have the table of electronegativities available, and you can find it in your reference packet for Chem 121. So this is the first page of the reference packet, second page, third page that pertains to chapter 3, and then page 4 is for chapter 4. You have the electronegativity table here with the values for each element, and then the electronegativity difference that allows us to classify bonds is a table we will need also for that section. We have already been using the table that is below on the same page, and that is also used in chapter 4 to determine the molecular shape of molecules. So have this page of your reference packet before your eyes. So if the electronegativities of two bonded atoms are equal or similar, the bond will be classified as nonpolar. For example, in a C-C bond, a carbon-to-carbon bond, the electronegativities for carbon is 2.5, and the other carbon is also 2.5. Because it's the same type of atom, they will attract the electrons towards themselves the same way. And so this way, they will share equally. The electrons in the bond will be shared equally between the two carbons, and we will classify this bond as nonpolar. Another type of nonpolar bonds is when the electronegativity difference is small between two atoms. For example, in the C-H bond, the electronegativity on carbon is 2.5, and the electronegativity on hydrogen is 2.1. It's a difference of 0.4, and this is considered nonpolar as well because the electronegativity difference is small enough to be ignored. So we consider that the C-H bond is a nonpolar bond where electrons are being shared equally between the carbon and the hydrogen. When bonding between atoms with different electronegativities happen, it yields to a polar covalent bond or a dipole. So the example here shows a CO bond, carbon-oxygen bond. Carbon has an electronegativity of 2.5, oxygen has an electronegativity of 3.5, and it's a difference of 1.0. This is a large enough electronegativity difference that will make oxygen pull more strongly on the electrons. So the electrons are pulled towards oxygen, the more electronegative element, and this is indicated by the symbol delta minus. The delta minus here is indicating a partial negative charge. It's the delta here symbolizes a very small fraction over one. It's a very small percentage. And so the electrons are pulled away from carbon because carbon is less electronegative. And this is indicated by the symbol delta plus. Again, delta means it's a very small proportion. And so delta plus indicates a partial positive charge on carbon. So the electrons in this bond are not equally shared. They are unequally shared between the carbon and the oxygen. And because of that, it develops a dipole or a polarity that we represent with an arrow. So the dipole is represented with an arrow that points towards the more electronegative element. In this case, it's oxygen. And the other end of the arrow has a like a plus sign that is pointing towards the less electronegative element. In this case, it's carbon. So when you want to represent a polar bond, you can choose to do the delta plus, delta minus, or you can represent it using a dipole arrow like this. So this is showing you the difference between polar bonds and non-polar bonds. To the left, you have the hydrogen molecule, which has a non-polar bond between the two hydrogens. Because it's two hydrogens, two of the same type of atom, they will pull on the electrons the same way. So then the electrons will be shared equally between the two hydrogens. And that's a non-polar covalent bond. In the case of hydrogen and chlorine, chlorine is more electronegative than hydrogen. Chlorine has an electronegativity of 3.0. Hydrogen has an electronegativity of 2.1. That's a difference of 0.9. This is considered polar. It's a polar covalent bond between hydrogen and chlorine. And so on the bottom here, you see how it is represented by having the delta plus around the hydrogen and delta minus on the chlorine side. So chlorine is pulling the electrons toward itself more strongly, and so it develops a partial negative charge. And because the electrons are lacking around the hydrogen, then hydrogen develops a partial positive charge. And so you can see with the electron clouds that, you know, hydrogen seems to have, seems to be missing its electron. And chlorine, you know, grabbed them for himself, and they look like they're more in the chlorine electron cloud than the hydrogen electron cloud. So that represents an unequal sharing of electrons. So this table is the table you have in your reference packet. It indicates how we will classify bonds depending on the electronegativity difference value. So if you have an electronegativity difference between the two atoms that are bonded that is less than 0.5, the bond will be classified as nonpolar. It's called a nonpolar covalent bond. And that means that the electrons are shared equally between the two atoms. If the electronegativity difference between the two atoms is between 0.5 and 1.9 included, both values included, then the bond is classified as polar covalent. In this case, the electrons are not equally shared. They are pulled towards the more electronegative element. And this is represented by the middle molecule here, the molecule in the middle, where you see the delta plus and the delta minus. These delta plus and delta minus represent partial positive charge and partial negative charge. The partial negative charge is on the side of the more electronegative element. If the electronegativity difference between the two atoms is greater than 1.9, so from 2.0, it is classified as an ionic bond. It means the electrons are transferred from the less electronegative element to the more electronegative element. We know that an ionic bond is made of ions, and so the molecule on the right here, where you have a complete full plus and a full negative charge here, are representing ions. We have a cation and an anion. The electron has left the cation and the atom that became a cation, and now it has joined the atom that now is an anion. And so it's a complete transfer of the electron from one atom to another. And we have now a cation and an anion, and they are strongly attracted because they are made of opposite charges. And so that's typical of an ionic bond. So let's practice classifying bonds as polar or nonpolar. And for this, we will calculate the electronegativity difference. So here, let's start with silicon and sulfur. So the value for silicon, the electronegativity for silicon is 1.8 and sulfur is 2.5. So when you calculate the electronegativity difference, you always take the larger value minus the smaller value. And so here, 2.5 for sulfur minus 1.8 for silicon, it's a difference of 0.7. According to the table that is shown again below, a difference of 0.7 is classified as a polar covalent bond. So this is a polar covalent bond. CS and Cl, when they are bonded together, that's cesium and chlorine. The electronegativity for cesium is 0.7 and chlorine is 3.0. So you will do 3.0 minus 0.7, and that's a difference of 2.3. This is a large difference, greater than 1.9, and so the bond is classified as ionic according to the table below. And this can be confirmed by the fact that cesium is on the left side of the periodic table, it's a metal. And chlorine is on the right side of the periodic table, it's a non-metal. And we already know that, by definition, ionic compounds are made of metal and non-metals. So this confirms why CS and Cl together are making an ionic bond. Si and P. Silicon has a value of 1.8 and phosphorus 2.1. So you do the larger value, 2.1 minus 1.8, and it's a difference of 0.3. 0.3, according to the bottom table here, is less than 0.5, which means it's a non-polar covalent bond. So the silicon phosphorus bond is non-polar. So let's do some more practice. With the followings, and this time we will also add a dipole if we have a polar bond. Only in the case of a polar bond, you do not use dipoles for ionic bonds or non-polar bonds. So PbO. Pb, lead has an electronegativity of 1.8 and oxygen has an electronegativity of 3.5. So you will do the larger value, 3.5 minus 1.8. That's a difference of 1.7. 1.7 is large, but it's still considered a polar covalent bond. So it's a polar covalent bond. That means we will need to show an arrow that will show which atom is pulling the electrons toward itself more strongly. And so here, oxygen is the one with the value of 3.5. So it's pulling the electrons toward itself more strongly than lead. So the arrow will have to point towards oxygen, and the little plus on the other side is towards lead. Notice here how lead is on the left side of the staircase line, and it's a metal. oxygen is on the right side and it's a non-metal. So here we have an example of a bond that we would classify as ionic if we didn't look at the electronegativity difference. And so most of the time when we will deal with compounds, that's how you want to classify bonds. This can also be called an ionic bond because we have a metal and a non-metal. But if we look at the electronegativity difference, it's still on the side of polar covalent. So this shows you how it's a continuum between, you know, going from non-polar to polar to ionic, right? It's not, the boundaries are not set. Suddenly you change from one to the other. So what I mean is that it's a continuum. And here, if we didn't look at the electronegativity difference, we would have classified this as ionic bond and it would have been correct. So let's look at NCl. Nitrogen has an electronegativity of 3.0. Chlorine has also an electronegativity of 3.0. So they pull on the electrons with equal strength, and the electronegativity difference is zero. And when we have a zero difference, it's a non-polar covalent bond. Electrons are equally shared between nitrogen and chlorine. SRF. SR, strontium, and fluorine. Fluorine has a value of 4.0, strontium 1.0. It's a difference of 3. And that is ionic. It's clearly ionic. And when you see where is strontium, it's definitely to the left of the periodic table. Fluorine is the most electronegative element. It's a non-metal. So strontium, a metal, fluorine, a non-metal, they make an ionic compound. HO. Oxygen has a value of 3.5, hydrogen has a value of 2.1, it's a difference of 1.4, and 1.4 is between 0.5 and 1.9, and it's considered a polar covalent bond. So here again we have a polar covalent bond, so we will need a dipole to show which element is more electronegative between the two. And that's oxygen. So the arrow should point towards oxygen. And the positive sign of the arrow is pointing towards the hydrogen.